really only doing 1040. 1040 EV or 1040 A, people, if they have those, they're either going to do them themselves, or I saw a sign at H&R Block saying that they'll do them for free. So, because they're really simple, there's not really anything on it.
Good. Okay.
I think it's working.
Okay. It's just cutting off half the screen.
I wasn't sure. I think it's working. Okay.
We're going to go with it.
Thank you. So if you look at this sheet again, this kind of lays out the different types of 1040. Okay. So the first one up here is 1040 EZ. I wrote it all on the sheet for you guys because I didn't feel like writing it on the board. Okay. So a 1040 EZ can be used by a taxpayer who is not over 65 or blind, has taxable income of less than $100,000, has only wages, salaries, tips, scholarships, unemployment comp, and interest income of $1,500 or less, does an itemized claim adjustments to income, so remember adjustments to income are those above the line deductions on page one, claim any dependency exemptions or claim any credits other than the earned income credit. Okay? And they can only have a filing status is married filing jointly or single. And if you turn on the back page, this is for the 1040A, which is also known as the short form, which is a little bit more expansive than the 1040EZ. You can take a look at the requirements. The taxpayer still has to have income of less than $100,000. In addition, the taxpayer has to use the standard deduction. They can't have income other than wages, salaries, tips, unemployment comp, dividends, interest, the list. They can have some above the line deductions, unlike a 1040EZ, but there are limits to which ones they can use. Okay? And you can look here at this list of these adjustments that are allowed. They can also have credits, but again, there are limits on what credits they can claim. If they want to claim anything else or have deductions other than what's allowed on this list, they have to file a 1040. Okay? So I just wanted to hand that out to you. There's no slides on that. It is mentioned briefly in the book, but I wanted to mention it. So, the last topic in this chapter, okay, it is a very important chapter. I mean, a very important topic. Honestly, it's probably the most important topic in this class, and we have discussed it a little bit. The first week of class, we talked about it a little. We're talking about it some today. And the last chapter that we cover in this class, chapter 14, is also on this material. And the reason why I think it's very important is because if you take other tax classes, this part really transfers. You will use these concepts in all areas of tax. Okay? So, this is talking about property transfer. Anytime you dispose of property, maybe a stock, real property, equipment, any kind of property. Now, the word dispose does not just mean sale. Okay? We're talking about trading with somebody else, gifting it to somebody else, contributing it to a corporation or a partnership. The word disposing does not necessarily just mean selling. You can see dispositions. We talk about dispositions in the code. Okay? So just know that we're not just talking about sales. Okay? So the first thing we need to know is amount realized. We talked about amount realized before. This is the amount that you actually receive when you dispose of a piece of property, when you sell it. The amount of value that you're getting, usually in cash. Okay? Now, you can deduct from amount realized any sort of adjustments, like if you had to pay a real estate agent, for example, to sell your property. You could take that at amount realized. We take amount realized and we subtract our basis. Basis is, of course, what you paid for, your cost, okay? Plus any additions you might make. So, for example, let's say you buy a house and you spend $60,000 on this house.
and then you spend $10,000 to build a road on the property.
That's a capital addition, and that increases your basis. Your basis can also be decreased, okay, by depreciation. So, let's say with this piece of property, you depreciate $5,000 in the first year.
So that's going to reduce your basis by $5,000, which creates an ending basis at the end of the year of
$65,000. So, we'll talk about depreciation deductions in a couple of chapters. But a depreciation deduction is a current deduction that you get, okay, against your regular income, and it reduces the overall tax that you pay. But if you choose to take a depreciation deduction, you have to also reduce your basis. What effect does this create? So when you eventually sell the property, are you going to have more gain or less gain?
More,
right? Because your basis is lower. Okay? So what this effectively does, when you take a depreciation deduction, you get a current tax benefit, i.e. a current deduction, but later, when you sell the property, you are going to have more gain, okay? It can effectively be a wash, depending upon the change in the value of the property, okay? So, when you take amount realized minus basis, you get gain realized. Okay? Now, we talked about this before. We said that gain realized equals gain recognized unless there is an exception in the code. So there are some code sections that turn off gain recognition. Now remember, recognition is what creates taxable income. Just having gain realized does not actually produce tax. It has to be recognized, okay? For purposes of this class, gain realized is really pretty much always going to be the same. We'll talk about a few exceptions. But just know that with gain, there has to be an express exception in the code to turn off recognition. What about losses? Let's say you have your amount realized minus your basis, and that gives you a loss realized. Loss realized works opposite to gain, and that loss realized equals loss recognized only if the code allows. So here, it works opposite. We assume that there is taxable income or gain recognition unless the code says differently. With losses, we assume that that loss is not going to be used as a deduction. It's not a recognized loss unless the code permits it. What we actually say is allowed. The word with losses is allowed. Is the loss allowed? Okay? It's fine to say is the loss recognized. That means can you use it as a deduction for tax purposes. But normal jargon is we say, is it allowed? Okay? Alright. If you are selling a personal item, like a car or a boat, okay, anything that is completely personal to you, and you have a loss on it, that loss is not recognized. Okay?
That means you can't use it for tax purposes.
But what happens if you're selling stock?
Well, stock is considered to be for investment, right? That's what people do. It's just stocks. They go and buy it. It's an investment. Maybe you buy land as an investment, okay? And you sell that piece of investment property or your stock, and there's a loss. Well, that is allowed. That is recognizable because it's for investment purposes. Know that the key with loss, to be able to use it, it has to be either for business purposes or for investment purposes. There are a couple exceptions out there. And actually, there is a whole chapter on losses. I have elected to skip it. We're not covering it in this class. But for losses, just know, for the most part, it has to be either for business purposes or investment purposes. Okay. There are, the first step is determine if it's residence. You have a gain or a loss, determine if it's residence. The second step, so I'll say recognition. The second step, okay, is determine the character. This means, is it ordinary or capital? So an ordinary gain or an ordinary loss, okay, is essentially going to be subject to the progressive rate with the highest currently being 39.6%. Okay, so these are your regular income tax rates that we actually talked about in the last class when we were calculating our tax rates with our tax methods and our tax schedules, remember? Okay. If it is capital, there are two possibilities, okay? It can either be long-term capital gain or short-term capital gain, or loss. Gain plus loss. For it to be short-term capital gain or loss, it has to be held for less than or equal to 12 months. Whatever the piece of property is. So it's all about holding period. How long the taxpayer held the property. If they have held it for less than or equal to 12 months, it's short-term. If it's more than 12 months, it's long-term. Okay? Now, what's the difference? Short-term capital gain is taxed at this revenue. The same rate as ordinary. Long-term capital gain has essentially three options for how it's taxed for individuals. 28%, 25%, or 20% to zero. Which bucket it falls into is entirely dependent upon the item itself, the item being sold. For example, 28% is collectible. So, for example, you sell your stamp collection, your antique car collection. That is considered to be a collectible, and although it is considered to be long-term, it is taxed at 28%. Okay? 25% is rare. You don't see this a lot. This is known as unrecaptured 1250 gain. Okay, and this isn't applied to me. You don't see this a lot. 1250 gain is related to depreciation of buildings. Okay? And then the last bucket, 20% to 0%, okay, is related to the taxpayer's progressive rate.
okay? So this is progressive rate. I'll move over here. If you have a taxpayer in the 39.6 bracket, their long-term capital gains are going to be taxed at 40%. Okay? If the taxpayer is in the 15% or below bracket, their long-term capital gains are taxed at 0%. If the taxpayer is in between, which most taxpayers are, they are taxed at 15% for long-term capital gains. So the option is either 20%, 0%, or 15%.
So like I said, your first step, determine if something is recognized. The second step, determine the character. Is it ordinary or is it capital? Okay, how do you know what is capital? Okay, capital assets are any asset other than inventory, accounts receivable, or depreciable property used in a business on 567. Most personal assets, like cars and houses, are capital assets. Okay? So, now let's talk about the third step. What's the third step that you're already doing? So, and this is a chart of what essentially exactly what I have here. Okay? So the third step is what I call the netting rules. Okay? With the netting rules, we net short-term capital gains with short-term capital loss. We net long-term capital gains with long-term capital loss. Okay? Then you can net this to get a net gain or a net loss. There's some notes, okay? If you have a short-term capital loss, a net short-term capital loss, it will offset long-term capital gain by category, highest first. We'll do an example, and you will see what I'm talking about. Okay, so let's do an example. First example is example 44, okay, in the book. Okay, this example, during the current year, Ted sails his sailboat, okay, with a basis of 9.46. Okay, he sells his sailboat with a $4,000 basis. He sells it for $5,500. That's his amount realized. So what's his gain here? $1,500, that's right. That's his gain. Is that recognized? The second thing that he sells is his personal automobile,
with an adjusted basis of $8,000, and he sells it for $5,000. So, what does that create? A $3,000 loss. Is that allowed for residents? No, because it is for the sale of personal assets. So, what this taxpayer has to report is a $15,000 capital gain, depending upon how long he has a boat, either long term or short term. Okay? Now we have example 46. We have Colin, the third taxpayer. He's in a 35% bracket. But you have to know do his property. And he has the following capital transactions during the year. He sells Penguin stock held for 8 months. Okay? He has a $1,000 gain. So it says this is a $1,000 gain. Okay? So, first of all, is this gain recognized? Yes. Is it long term or short term? Short term. So I'll put it out here on the side, short term capital gain and joint offering. Okay? Next, we have all stock that was held for 10 months. And it produces a $3,000 loss. Is this recognized? Yes, it is recognized. Okay? Because it's an investment. Okay, you invest in stock. Losses for investment or business purposes are allowed. Okay? So this is an allowable loss or recognized loss. It's held for 10 months. So it's going to be a short-term capital loss. We have a stamp collection held for 5 years. Okay, and he sells it and for $2,000 gain. This is recognized, right? Is it long term or short term? Long term. And it's taxable at 28%, remember. Okay? Is it a collectible? We have land, which is held as an investment for 3 years. It's an investment piece of property. Okay? And he sells it for a $4,000 gain, long term or short term? Long term, capital gain. Okay? Since this taxpayer is in the 35% bracket, what's going to be his rate for this? In a bracket 15 or below, so his capital gain rate is going to be 15% for this piece of property. Now, the first thing that we do is net our netting rules. So we're going to net short term with short term and long term with long term. Okay? So what is his net short term capital gain or loss? Right, loss of $2,000, and then short term with short term. So that equals a net short term capital loss of $2,000. Okay, now he also has a $2,000 long term capital gain and a $4,000 long term capital gain. There's not really anything here to net per se because you don't have any losses. Okay, you could add them up and say $6,000. But it doesn't make sense because, I erased it, but when we have a short-term capital loss, we can offset this with long-term gain. Well, which one do we start with? The highest first. So we're going to offset our $2,000 short-term capital loss with our $2,000 long-term capital gain, which is in our 28%.
So that means this taxpayer has to recognize $4,000 of long-term capital gain taxable at 15%. Because we can offset it with this loss. We have a short-term capital loss, and we can net this with a long-term capital gain. And we start with the highest bracket first, the 20, which is 28%. Okay? Okay. Now, look at this slide right here. So I'll just go through another example. This slide. So if a taxpayer, it doesn't, not with this one, because we had an overall gain. But if after we do all our netting, the taxpayer has a loss, a net capital loss, they can use that loss up to $3,000 a year. Anything else has to be carried forward to future years. For corporations, they don't get to use any of it. They only get to use capital losses to the extent they have capital gains. Individuals get an extra perk just by being individuals, and you get to use $3,000 of capital loss a year. Okay? So here's an example. Okay? In 2016, Tina has a short-term capital loss of $2,000, okay, and a long-term capital loss of $2,500. So how much of this is she going to get to use in 2016? $3,000, right? And how much will she have to carry forward to use in the future? $1,500. Is that $1,500 carry forward? Is it going to be long term or is it going to be short term?
Long
term. Long term, that's right. Because short term goes first. So always remember that. You write it down. Short term goes first. The same way we knock out the higher bracket first. It works the exact same. Short term goes first. So they're using all of their short term, okay? And they're using $1,000 of their long term. So they will have $1,500 of long term capital loss to carry forward into 2017. Okay? We have a big picture back here. You will remember our taxpayer sold her wedding ring for a capital loss of $2,800. Is this an allowable loss? No. Not at all. It's entirely personal use. Okay? I couldn't imagine a business use wedding ring. So it's entirely personal. You could, maybe you were invested in, you know, gold or something and you had some jewelry that you investment, you sold it, that could be it. Okay. But,
yes. If you don't buy your own wedding ring, can you still take a loss on it?
You couldn't take a loss anyway because it's not personal.
I know, but like,
I get what you're saying, but
or if it was a gain, like could I take a gain even though I didn't buy it?
No, you would have to be the one that bought it. Because you'd have to be the one to pay, right? So, but if you think about it, let's say her husband bought it for her, okay? And he gives it to her as a gift. So when you gift something, what basis do you get? Well, we haven't talked about it. You get a transfer basis. So if he paid $10,000 for the ring, when he gives it to his spouse, she has a $10,000. She has that transfer basis. So when she sells it later, she will have a gain because she got a transfer basis from herself. Okay. All right. And yes, you had a gain. You athletes, but I mean, hardly anyone's gonna have a game that they sell their union with. We're lucky we can sell it out. So, okay. We've already talked to you. We're done with this.
We have one other example I wanna do, okay?
This is example 49, okay? We have Holly, who is in the 15% bracket, okay? And she has the following capital gains during the year. She has Robin stock, which was held for 6 months, okay? And she sold it for $1,000 gain. She has Crow stock, which she held for 13 months, and she sells for a $1,000 gain. So, and the question asks, figure out her tax liability for the year. Is this long-term or short-term? Short-term, okay? Long-term or short-term? Long-term. Okay. So, what is this $1,000? What tax rate are we going to use to figure out our tax liability for the sale of Robin's stock?
15.
Correct. 15, because she's in the 15% bracket. Short-term capital gains. For short-term, we use whatever bracket the taxpayer is in for their ordinary income tax. Okay? So she pays tax on $1,000. Times 15% equals $150. What about for this $1,000 that's long-term capital gain? What rate do we use? 0%, that's right, because she's in a 15 or under. So $1,000 times 0% equals zero. So her total tax liability for these transactions is $150. Now we assume that Polly is in the 33% bracket. Okay? So, what tax rate do we use for her short-term capital gain? 33%, that's right, which equals $330. What do we use for her long-term capital gain? 15%, that's right, which equals $150. So her total tax liability for these two transactions was $480. Same transactions, but depending upon the tax bracket that the taxpayer is in, it can have very different tax consequences. Okay. So it's for the chapter. I'll see you all next time for the example.